Hello. In this video, we'll look at building a custom chatbot end-to-end, including both the AI, ML, as well as the front-end. We'll do that in a really simple way with less than 100 lines of code. The application will use Google Kubernetes Engine and specifically GKE Autopilot for a turnkey and simple deployment approach. We're going to fully productionalize this application, including using Kubernetes ingress resources so that you get production-grade load balancing in front of your application. This demonstration will also show you how to have Google-managed TLS certificates for HTTPS and how to start thinking about security services like CloudArmor. Now, if you were to provide this application to the public internet and potentially malicious users, you would probably want to layer on some additional security controls and possibly additional networking infrastructure. But this should give you a really solid starting point and could even be used for simple internal use cases. We are going to be using the best models that Google has put out within their Vertex AI machine learning suite on Google Cloud Platform. As Google develops and publishes new models to this platform, we'll be able to use them really easily using the same architecture. Note that the web application we're going to be developing is with the Flask Web Framework, which is Python-based development. However, if you're used to a different web application framework, you should find the concept still relatively portable. Similarly, we're going to be using Artifact Registry on Google Cloud for an easy experience around publishing and using our Docker image, but you could certainly do things like pushing your images to Docker Hub. With our goal established, let's jump into the Google Cloud console to set up some of these resources, and we'll also use an IDE to set up the code. So, in the Google Cloud console, we'll go to Kubernetes Engine and then create an autopilot cluster before jumping into some of the code here. I'm going to accept the defaults except for the cluster name. All right, now let's start to look at the code. We know that we're going to need a directory for the application code, which is the Flask application. We'll have this application be a single Python file for relaying API calls, and then we'll use an index file for the front end. In this web application, we're going to combine two things, some boilerplate and standard code for our Flask web app, which is an open source project, and some code that we get from Vertex AI on how to use Google's PaLM models with Python. We'll be able to contextualize this in the Generative AI Studio, specifically in the chat section. Here, we can see a few things that we can include in our chatbot, such as examples that help the model understand what we're looking for in responses, and context that helps it understand what it should do. We'll keep things simple, though, and just use the default setup, which gives us a nice text-based chat experience. So, let's first focus on our application code in our app.py file. We're going to be importing some libraries focused on the Flask Web Framework and the Vertex AI Suite. We'll be handling some configuration and model setup on the Google side of things, including setting a project ID and location, which we'll get from environment variables or use some defaults if not provided. We have some boilerplate Flask code, which serves our index.html file from the static directory whenever we have a GET request to the homepage. Then we have our API for the chatbot requests. The idea here is that we're getting input from this API call using the chatbot to receive that message, and then returning the response as part of this API. Now, in our front-end HTML, JavaScript, and CSS code, we'll make use of this API. This is all pretty light, with just 41 lines of code in the Python file and 58 lines of code for our front end. As for the sessions, it's important to keep in mind that chatbots need to be contextual. We can instruct our chatbot to act in certain ways or provide it with certain context in the chat dialogue, and it will use that context in further responses. For example, we can ask the chatbot to pretend it's a pirate and then answer questions while incorporating that context into its responses. We need to retain context in our application and have that context apply across requests. For this approach, we're going to use client-side session management and have our chat sessions in memory for our application. We have an in-memory chat sessions dictionary where we'll be creating chatbot sessions for each new user identified by a session ID cookie. All this code here is just saying that if this user has already established a chatbot session, let's continue to use that session, and if not, let's create a new session. When we interact with the chatbot on the Vertex AI Google Cloud platform, we're going to save new messages and updates back to that chat session so that the history is maintained and context is used in future responses. Now, there are projects like Flask sessions that allow for more advanced forms of session management. This is fairly primitive, and if you had many different chat sessions, this could take up a meaningful amount of memory. This also means that whenever we shut down or restart the application, we're going to lose those sessions. But the approach we have here now will work just fine as a starting point. We have a couple of limitations, but you can revise this approach if you need to in your own application. Next up, let's populate the requirements file, which is pretty straightforward. We just have a few dependencies here: Flask, GUnicorn for running our Flask application, and the Vertex AI Platform SDK. In our index.html file, let's create some code for our chatbot. We'll start with some basic styling and then define our page structure, which is just going to be a chatbot window and an input field for sending user messages to the chatbot. We also need a couple of JavaScript functions for appending new messages to the chat box and for sending messages to our API at the API chatbot endpoint, as we had defined in our Flask code. We're going to implement CloudArmor rate limiting so that only up to one request per minute will be accepted, otherwise it will throw a 429 error. This will ensure that we don't have tons of requests to our application, which could end up meaning a lot of prompts and cost in Vertex AI. With this in mind, we handle an error if a user tries to submit too many chat messages within 1 minute. Now that we have our application, let's go ahead and view it using the web preview feature in the Cloud Shell IDE to securely view the website, even though it doesn't have a public IP. Here's the idea. We've got our chat box window and messages that we can submit in the box at the bottom. Currently, if we say hello, we get an error because we have not yet set up the backend API. However, once we do set up the application properly on Kubernetes, we'll be able to successfully submit messages and interact with our custom chatbot. Let's do precisely that, and now we'll focus on Dockerizing our application. In the Docker file, we're going to keep things pretty simple. Just bringing in the application code, installing the required Python dependencies, and running the application with GUnicorn. We're leaning into heavy logging here in both our Python unbuffered setting and our log level debug for GUnicorn. We'll test build this application, and if successful, we'll push this to Artifact Registry in Google Cloud, where we'll store the container image and then use it in our Google Kubernetes Engine cluster. Once the build is successful, let's go ahead and set up an Artifact Registry repository for our container image. We tend to recommend regional instead of multi-regional configurations for your Docker repositories, mainly for cost reasons. However, in either case, this is a pay-per-use service and should be relatively inexpensive if you don't have a large volume and size of images. So if we go into our repository, we'll check out the setup instructions and configure our local Docker CLI to use that repository. We'll also grab the path for this repository and use it in our Docker tag. We could either rerun the Docker build command or just take our test latest image and retag it. Now note that we have a pretty turnkey experience around the authentication here because we're using the Cloud Shell IDE. If you're using an IDE environment on your local laptop or elsewhere outside of Google Cloud, you'll probably need to activate a service account or use something like the gcloud init command to set up the authentication to perform these operations. Back in our artifact registry, we can go ahead and refresh, and we see our application coming up nicely. Now, let's look at how we can run our application on Kubernetes using a resources.yaml file and discuss all the concepts. So we have a number of resources that we're going to deploy to our Kubernetes cluster to enable this application. We have some HTTP and front-end type configurations for our networking, which will provide us a managed certificate so we can have HTTPS connections to our custom domain. Note that you can scale down some of this networking if you'd like. These additional layers of security and custom domains are optional. We also have a backend configuration that we're going to use for our CloudArmor security policy, which will provide rate limiting on our chatbot requests and will be attached to our chatbot service. Next, we have our chatbot ingress, which will be backed by Google Cloud load balancing and will combine some other configurations and define routing for our application. Finally, we have our container wrapped in a deployment resource using the artifact registry image and tag and providing a service account. First, let's talk about the security policy in CloudArmor. We're going to create a policy, give it a name that matches the one specified in the Kubernetes resource, and then create a backend security policy. We need just one rule for rate limiting, where if there are more than one request per minute, we'll deny that request with the 429 error. Next, we need to set up our IP and RBAC resources. Let's first set up the IP. We need a global static IP, which can be provisioned with the gcloud command. Make sure the name matches the one in the Kubernetes configuration. Lastly, let's set up a service account that our application can use to call our large language models in Vertex AI. By default, our workloads will not have that level of permission, and tighter controls might be desired. We'll provide some additional commands here in the console for setting up both IAM and Kubernetes RBAC. Note that all these commands can be found in the GitHub repo linked in the video description. We're going to create a service account on the IAM side named Chatbot, and then give that service account permissions on the AI platform, specifically the user role. This is a pre-built role that includes a number of permissions, one of which involves invoking the APIs for our large language models in Vertex AI. Next, we need to join this IAM service account with the service account that we're using in Kubernetes, also named Chatbot. This command joins them through the workload identity user role, providing the namespace and the name of the service account at the end of the member string. Since it's complaining about a project, let's go ahead and set that at the terminal level here and then rerun the commands. We could have just as easily provided that as a flag in our command. Now to finish, we just need to create the Kubernetes side of things as far as service accounts, and we'll need the cluster up and running to do that. Let's check on our cluster, which has been provisioning for a while, and it looks like it's ready to go. We'll configure kubectl to use that cluster, and then create our service account and bind it to the IAM role with an annotation. All right, so we're all set with all those resources. Now we can provision this out and they'll all run. Note that the managed certificate here does require an ACME challenge, and specifically, Google will use the HTTP ACME challenge to provision the certificate, so we do need to take our IP and use it for an A record on this domain. We created the IP through a gcloud command, but we can also see it in the console here. We're going to grab this IP address and use it in an A record for this domain. We can go ahead and set that up now, although it's not strictly required before we apply these resources. We just won't be able to fully provision the certificate until that step is executed. Google Cloud does have a DNS service, but you can set up this A record with any provider of your choosing. Now, I think we're looking pretty good, so we'll apply the resources.yaml file, and our resources will start to provision. It looks like our application is running nicely, while our ingress is still working on the cloud load balancing resources that will back it. There are no errors, though, and everything looks good. Typically, the managed certificate is going to be the slowest thing to provision, since Google needs to run an HTTP ACME challenge that needs to resolve before we can use the certificate. We can check on the progress of that provisioning in the load balancing page. Now this is going to create a public web app for our demo chatbot, and the only security control here is the rate limiting. So if you're following along, you may want to add IP whitelisting to your CloudArmor policies, or otherwise further secure this with authentication structures and protection against abuse, since we've effectively extended the use of our Vertex AI large language models into this public-facing application. Those additional security layers don't necessarily need to be complex, they just need to be thoughtful. For example, if we go into our backend configuration, we can see our chatbot's backend security policy, and we can enable adaptive protection to further improve our security a bit without any real work or configuration. For anyone interested in a simple OAuth 2-based authentication layer, which fits nicely into our demonstrated architecture, we'll provide a video link in the description. In any case, remember to layer on the security that's required for your context or just deploy this application on a private environment. Once our certificate has successfully provisioned, we can see it as active in the console, and then we can go to our newly created website. Let's give this a try and see if we need to tune anything before being able to use the application. Since I tested accessing this on my other screen, we're actually getting the rate limiting already. We'll need to wait a full minute since I just accessed the website on my other screen, and then we'll be able to see the interface and make chat requests. Now that I've refreshed the page, we can see our chatbot here. We'll test it out, but we'll probably get a 429 error since it's been less than a minute. We do end up getting that error, so we'll give it just a couple more seconds and then make a request. As we wait, let's note the pricing for this application. The compute pricing for the autopilot cluster is fairly straightforward and relatively low. However, significant usage of the chatbot can definitely drive up the cost. With this chat bison model, we have a max input of about 4,000 tokens. And since we pay per character for the Vertex AI pricing, each request to our chatbot can cost up to about 1.6 cents. If you have many users sending numerous messages, these costs can add up. But with our rate limiting set to one request per minute, the max cost per user would be around 96 cents per hour. Now let's test the chatbot once more. Here we can see that when we send hello, the chatbot responds with, "Hello, how can I help you today?" Importantly, I want to highlight that we do have context here and our chatbot can adapt to the course of the conversation. You may want to adjust the rate limiting if you want a more fluid conversation with your chatbot, but we'll leave those specific configuration choices up to you. Now, as we wait another 60 seconds to pose our question to our pirate, it's an opportune moment to remind everyone that you can add more customization to these base models. By visiting the Generative AI Studio, and specifically the text chat, you can use the context and example options to make your chatbot more tailored to your specific use case. These customization points can also be leveraged in your Python code. Even though these are optional, they can greatly enhance the chatbot's responses, making them more specific and nuanced to your own scenario. We hope that this architectural pattern serves as a solid foundation for you to build upon when creating your own custom chatbot applications. Please feel free to leave any questions in the comment section. We'll be monitoring it closely. We'd like to thank you for watching and remind you to please enjoy responsibly.